One thing which I have found very useful is that, see, when the things are going good, there's really no problem. But especially when you have a problem, say if you have a complication or if your patient's vision is not improved according to his or her expectations, this patient is going to go to the optometrist room first, isn't it? And a vision will be checked. Post-operative patient, day one patient enters your optometrist room, the vision is counting fingers. It can be a possibility, right? Now, what is the, when you say communication, is it only about spoken words? It's about the body language and the tone and the tenor of your voice. So they are looking at the optometrist's face and, you know, that kind of expression they have, the body language, because normally 90% of your, 95% of your patients, they might be seeing 6, 6, 6, 6. The optometrist is also used to seeing 6, 6. And he will keep on saying, nahi dikh raha, you're not able to see, you're not able to see. 3 times he's asking, you're not able to see. You need to train that optometrist. You need to talk to the optometrist. Because by the time the patient comes to your room, the patient already feels that there is a big complication. And the next few days when there are some 50 relatives are going to come and meet this patient, till the time your cornea clears up, he's going to say, pata nahi, I don't know what has happened in my eye. Okay? That eye will recover, but those 50 relatives who have met him and gone will have this lingering feeling that this surgery was done there and there was some problem. So where is the problem? You would handle it very well, I'm sure. But when the optometrist has not handled it correctly, not even the spoken words, he or she has not told anything also, but the body language, the facial expressions of this smiling optometrist before the surgery and this stunned optometrist after the surgery is going to convey a lot of information to your patients. Another thing, if there is an infection, if there is something like that, and you need to have the common communication. What, like Dr. Mohita said, it's very, very important that the communication should be the same. There should not be any discrepancy in the communication, because they, if they find a gap about of, in what you are telling and what your staff is telling, that is going to create a lot of confusion. So I will quickly run through this presentation of Dr. Gagan Dudeja. He is a senior NABH assessor and an oculoplasty surgeon at Narayan Netralaya. He couldn't be here. He's presenting a paper at the Rangachari session. So he's requested me to talk on his behalf. This is a fire we know at the Noida Metro Hospital at the Bhubaneswar. So what is the problem? Why did the fire happen? And it can happen. It is not that it will never happen in your hospital. Okay? You need to have fire safety, okay? Not as a part of any mandation or any benchmarking. Please go and get a fire audit done of your hospital. Even if you are remotely not thinking about NABH, see that a third-party fire audit is done and the basic firefighting equipments are there. Your staff is trained on mock drills on fire. This is very important. It can happen in your hospital also, okay? Electrical safety, looking at all these things, what do you think about this? Yes, you can prevent this. Facility inspection rounds have to be incorporated. Hazard identification, risk reduction, regular inspection and maintenance, staff training, mock drills, and inspection. So there has to be one person in your organization. A lot of people during this instruction course told you that job description is very important. Every person working in your organization should have written down job description, and one of your staff can have this job description of a facility safety officer also. Okay, besides doing what they are doing, but when they are a facility safety officer, they also have this added responsibility of going around for facility rounds in your organization. So there has to be a system of reporting of incidents. I also spoke about that, of falls, adverse drug events, and sentinel events. What are sentinel events? These are the never events. They should never happen in your organization. Right? A wrong eye surgery, wrong procedure. And that's where we spoke about a surgical safety checklist, that how that can prevent such an incidence in your hospital. 24/7 availability of all these things in your hospital. Medical gases, look into your emergency drug. Think that if you had a relative or you yourself had a kind of a cardiac arrest in your own hospital, will you be saved? Think about it. Is there somebody else who is trained on basic life support, on CPR? Do you have enough emergency drugs? Does your oxygen cylinder have oxygen? Does your nurse or staff or anybody knows how to open that oxygen cylinder and how to put a mask on your face? Very important. Occupational health hazards in healthcare, biological hazards, chemical hazards, physical hazards, ergonomic. We use a lot of disinfectants in our hospital, right? All these are hazardous substances. And you need to have the safety data sheets or the material safety data sheets for that, okay? Your staff should be aware, this can get spilled, this can go into the eyes, this can corrode your skin. Somebody can accidentally drink that. It has happened all the time, right? So you need to see if that happens, how is your staff ready to prevent that? So this is what I've already told you. Display information regarding hazardous things or warning signs. Spill management. If there is a patient who has vomited blood in your organization, this can lead to communicable diseases. How do you manage spills? And hand hygiene. In an ophthalmology hospital, when I go as an assessor, hand hygiene takes a back seat because we feel we are the clean branch. That's not true. Hand hygiene is still important, very important. And there is a wonderful hand hygiene tool, audit tool, which WHO has given, that is there in public domain. You can do once in a month, one of your staff can do a hand hygiene audit. That takes care of so many of your hospital acquired infection. In fact, that will reduce the number of absentees in your organization because all these common colds and all is because of lack of hand hygiene also. Safe injection and medication practices, extremely important. It can happen, things can go wrong. And we need to look into, especially if you are having a dispensary or a pharmacy, or even if not, if you're running an operation theater, you need to look at your medications. You need to look at where you're going to store them, what is the expiry dates, who is going to track them, what are the look-alike, sound-alike drugs, which are the high-risk drugs, and how will you take care of the high-risk drugs. Safe surgery, we already spoke about surgical safety checklist, and safety in accessing facility. Important, grab bars, we deal with elderly people. Look at your toilets, see whether they are they elderly friendly. Very, very important. And code blue, we spoke about code blue in the during this course before also, so I'll skip this part. But you need to have some codes in your hospital, especially the code pink, the code blue, and the code red. The code pink is when you have a child abduction or when a child is missing in your organization. Thank you so much. If there are any questions, I and Mohita can take them. But thank you for sticking by and sitting through. And I hope you've enjoyed this course. Hoping to see you all next year. Thank you so much.